Today, we're here to discuss the 1997 film Soul Food and whether it was fair that Teri, the eldest sister, was pressured into financially supporting the family and helping to solve their problems.
We recently asked viewers in a poll on the community tab this very same question, and the comments were extremely passionate. Y'all had a lot to say.
I'm Heit.
And I'm Cheri.
And this is Axiom Amnesia.
A lot of you requested that we cover this film, and I can't wait for us to talk about it. But first, we want to thank all of the supporters who've helped to make this video possible. If you want your name to appear alongside these contributors, make a one-time donation via Cash App or click the thanks button on this video. Or you can head on over to patreon.com/axiomamnesia or become a channel member by clicking the join button to enjoy all of the benefits of becoming a monthly subscriber.
For those of you who don't know, Soul Food is the story of three sisters who traverse complicated relationships with one another. In the movie Soul Food, the sisters have distinct and different personalities that influence how they relate to each other.
Teri is the eldest and is a strong-willed and ambitious attorney who takes charge of the family. She's often seen as the leader between the three sisters. Maxine, the middle sister, is a homemaker. She tends to be more emotional and is often at odds with Teri. Bird, the youngest sister, a hairstylist with her own shop, is more carefree and is still trying to find her place in the family. Despite their differences, the sisters ultimately love and support each other and come together for family when it matters most.
One of Teri's biggest issues is that everyone in the family looks to her to fix their problems, especially the financial ones. Early in the film, we find out that Teri is disgruntled about having loaned Bird the money to buy her own hair salon.
She spent more time getting her shop together than of following Lem around. Maybe she'd pay me back that loan.
You are not hurting because you gave Bird money for that shop.
As far as you're concerned, I'm an ATM.
Oh, you two hush up.
She start.
Maxine, finish those biscuits.
Teri, stop running down your family. Pay more attention to your own man. You're already on husband number two.
We also find out more about why there's such tension between Teri and Maxine. Well, Kenny, Maxine's husband, started out as Terry's boyfriend back in the day.
Jenny!
Mom stole Dad right out from underneath Aunt Terry's nose.
Terri, get the heck out of the car!
Terri, get out!
Oh, shit! Hey, get off, boy! Terri, come on now! Come on now! Hey, Terri!
When the sister's mother, Big Mama, is hospitalized and in a coma, Teri and Maxine go at it again.
Mama is in a coma.
I'm not gonna let her ruin a 40-year family tradition.
Don't you tell me about tradition. I am the oldest one. I am the responsible one. I'm the one who graduated from law school. You're the one that dropped out when you were 19.
After Big Mama passes away, Teri decides to relieve herself of the expense of the family home and puts it up for sale. Of course, Maxine and Bird object to this and are ready to fight to keep the house in the family.
Mama ain't even lukewarm in the ground yet, and that damn girl got her house for sale. We're gonna stop the sale of Mama's house. So I went to Kenny's lawyer and I drew up a motion to cease and desist.
As you can see, much of the conflict between the sisters stems from the dynamic of Teri giving a lot of financial help to her family and also being viewed as the responsible one. We took a poll in the community tab recently and we asked, in Soul Food, was it fair that Teri was the financial cleanup woman bearing the burden of paying for things for her family? And you guys decided that about 90% of you said it was not fair, and only 10% of you said it was fair and that, you know, Teri's doing what she's supposed to do. Were you surprised about those results?
I wasn't surprised about these results at all.
I was a little bit surprised at the results just because I wasn't expecting for so many people to say that it wasn't fair. I was thinking that more people would say, hey, you know, this is family. You got to do for family. But only 10% of you felt like what Teri was doing was fair. Do you think it was right for Teri to bear the financial burden for her family? Right.
Yeah, I think it was right. I think that's what she had to offer. That's what you do. Everybody in their family or in units have their roles. Just like if you believe in capitalism, everyone have their roles. The capitalist who got all the money is investing in all the infrastructure and all of that, right? So in a family, she got the money, you dole out the money, the other people don't have the money. If it's not, then nobody in the family would have, you have money and nobody else have money, and then you say, I'm not going to use my money, then the family don't have money, then what's the point of even having money? It's just to be selfish and hoard money for yourself. So that's what you do. Whatever you have to give and to contribute, that's what you should. What do you think?
I think that, yes, I think she was playing her role in the family, and that was her role. She had more. She should be giving more. And the thing that should be addressed and maybe discussed is the communication piece of it all. And I think everybody could feel better about stuff, and she could get her butt off her back if they actually talked about the feelings behind the actions. Well, this makes me feel like this when you act like that, or I don't like how you present this and that. And that's how you get to the point where you can really relate to a person and understand who they are. But in order for that to happen, we got to be willing to be vulnerable enough to say, hey, you know, when you did this, this hurt my feelings, instead of just coming out angry, bitter with the guns, because it's easier to do that in a way, right? It's easier to be mad at somebody and call them names and, you know, just be like, well, that's why you ain't got no money and that's why you broke. It's easier to say that than it is to actually say, hey, you know, this really bothered me.
Or to assess, because a lot of it is that people aren't assessing things. You just, I feel like this happened, that's wrong, instead of assessing, why is it like this? Mm-hmm. You know, why does this person not have the money that I have? Why is all of my family coming and asking me for money?
And what can I do to help? Because at the end of the day, everybody is not a predator. Like, I don't even think most people are predators and users and whatever. I just think that most people may not have maybe what you were gifted with, the ability to look at something and say, hey, this is how I could work this out. This is how I should do it. This is how I should approach it. Everybody didn't have that. Everybody doesn't have, like you said, the brain power to make that happen, or the mentors who showed them the way. Mm. Everybody didn't get those opportunities. And so the question we should be asking ourselves is, what can I do to help, to actually help? In some cases, you're just going to have to keep doling out the money.
And if you just want to be selfish and just be like, well, I make money, it's mine, then just say that and don't try to act like a noble person. Mm. Just come straight out and say it. I don't want to help family and community. I want everything to myself.
Yeah.
And then people will know where you stand.
Yeah.
Dion.
Woo! That was like a whole thing.
Let's take a look at some of your comments about this.
Pretty Little Nye says, I think Teri didn't mind paying for things because she knew that she was the breadwinner in the family. When they expected her to pay for any and everything instead of asking her first is when it became unfair. And then Sierra Liggins goes on to add to this comment, also, they didn't take her guidance. It's like they wanted her money, but not her input. I agree with this. I think that the line is that Teri definitely had an obligation. The obligation to her family to help out because she was the one with the most. But the question is, where does that line end?
I don't know about what Sierra said, where they don't take her guidance. Maybe she meant her input. Just because you're are contributing financially don't mean that people or you are the sole provider in that sense, that everyone should just fall in line with what you have to say on things. With the family dynamics, everybody is contributing their part of whatever they can to the family. So when it's like, hey, she's putting in money, maybe somebody else is better at the giving sorts of advice or maybe even guidance on what should happen or decision making about the family and the home. Just because you have the finances don't mean that you're the best at making financial decisions.
That's true.
Like with selling a home.
That's true. But you know the golden rule, not the regular golden rule, but the other golden rule, which is that he who has the gold makes the rules. And I think that far too many times the people who have the money are the ones who are like, it's my money, or I have money, so I get to dictate every aspect of what's going to go on. And if it's not, if it doesn't go my way, then you don't have my money or not, you don't have my support. So I think that because of how Teri was, that was the kind of fine line that folks had to kind of deal with, her being in charge, her wanting to be in control, because Teri was kind of like a little bit of a control freak. Wanting to be in control, but then also knowing that, hey, if I take help from her, then I'm going to kind of be obligated. And I mean, if we just kind of, like we always do, talk about this in terms of our everyday lives, you know, it's like if any of us think about somebody in your family and if they have to help you, we know that there are certain situations in which if we accept help, then we're also accepting the unspoken guidance from that person about what we should do. You know, like, I mean, and I don't know, let's just say you look up and you need money for a purchase like what Bird did. Bird bought her a shop, but she needed help to buy her shop and Teri gave her a loan for it. Well, then, you know, you kind of have to hear Terry's mouth until, and it shouldn't be this way, but I mean, people are people, and I find that it seems to be this way more than not.
Yeah, but I also think that somebody stating what they believe is different than you doing what somebody tells you to do just because they gave you money. Because what if she said, okay, and you're going to have a bar in your shop as well because I'm loaning you money?
I mean, and that's the gray line of it, right? Because how much of it is that you have to take the advice of the person?
Well, you don't have to take it at all.
But then,
unless it's an actual investment, right? She's like, it's a loan and I pay you back and I'm getting paid back. Not that she has actual stake into the company.
True. But the lines are so fuzzy with family, because even though you know that it is not an official, maybe actual investment, it is an investment in a general sense, in that she's investing her family so everybody can have money or have a means to, you know, make money.
But you would have to say it up front.
Yeah.
Before I give you this money, then you have to do this.
And
otherwise,
I think that's where things get messed up.
Yeah.
You know, people don't state the terms, so then they assume that they're going to have a certain amount of power and say so over a situation because they've contributed something financially and they didn't say anything. And, you know, so everybody's thinking whatever they think in their own head. No communication has taken place. And then you wind up with like snide remarks and stuff, like the conversation that happened in the kitchen where Teri is talking about having help to pay for Bird's shop. Black Nets Man says, yes, she was a victim, talking about Teri. Her sister betrayed Teri by having relations with her boyfriend. Her ex-boyfriend, soon-to-be brother-in-law, was laughing about the altercation between the sisters while two-timing Teri. Then, much later on, he attempts to lecture Teri about what Terry's mother wanted. Her cousin also betrayed her after giving shelter by cheating with her husband. Some black people who don't think Teri was a victim have a warped view that if a black person is uppity and or bougie, that they are asking for every bad thing to happen to them.
Yeah, I don't know what that has to do with the actual question.
Well, I think because it's tying in that the things that people have done to you and kind of like whether you deserved for investments to be made. And here's the line for me. I think that family is family is family. And the idea that you actually deserve what you get from your family in terms of the support and the care is kind of a gray line. I think you do things for people because they are family and that's that. And, you know, sometimes family don't treat you right. Sometimes family may do things that aren't right.
The whole thing is, oh, they treat her bad, so she shouldn't help financially and all this. Well, then don't even go around the family. Why are you even there cooking and doing Sunday dinner and interacting with people if you got this chip on your shoulder about it? And I don't want to do that. I just want to show up and eat the food that everybody cooked, but I don't want to contribute in any other way. I just want to be mad at everybody. Just don't go around.
And I think that's the complicated thing that we saw in this movie, right? This complicated relationship.
Yeah. And I don't think she was a so-called victim.
So what do you think about what happened between her and Maxine? And
They done her wrong. Yeah. A victim of what? I don't know. Betrayal.
Well,
like everybody go through something that happened. It's like, what?
Yeah. Her sister straight up betrayed her at one point. And
yeah,
it's the kind of betrayal that you have to continue to live through, right? Because you got to see this guy. And you know, there's even a scene later in the movie where she's at the house, and this is after she found out that her own husband had been had slept with the cousin Faith. You know, she hugs Kenny in a way that is more than just kind of friends, like almost
weren't
like
they talking about they should have been together.
Well, you know, kind of like not exactly, but I think that she didn't stop caring for him just because he had cheated on her. So this was like the thorn in her side the whole time, and it was wrong. And the thing about the way Maxine's personality was that she was just bold about it. She was like, oh, you know, and then just as much as Teri was holding the fact that she was an attorney and had money and throwing that in, and that she finished school, throwing that in her sister's face, Maxine was throwing the fact that she had this, the man that Teri used to even have, a family and everything, in her sister's face. And I think that that was just That dynamic is kind of ugly. And
yeah, but to wrap it into whatever finances is, I don't even get the point.
But that's the complexity of people, right? You feel like I've been done wrong, and so here's my control. My control is the money, and I'm going to act like I want to act about the money. I'm not saying it's right. I'm just saying that I feel like that was part of kind of the logic, and also maybe how Teri became how she was, right? Because maybe Teri wasn't quite this bad earlier on, but then after you have this constant, what she feels is usury, then, you know, she's just disgruntled.
But yeah, like, but usury is separate than, oh, I was betrayed when I was 18.
And people don't see it, right? They're just keeping this running list of everything somebody did bad to them. And they're like,
I'm gonna sell my mama's house. Like, okay.
Yeah, I mean, because it's not completely.
Yeah, but like
logical. It's just like emotional.
When Black Nets Med said some Black people who don't think that Teri was a victim, blah blah blah. It's like that is just fine. It's fine for her to just treat the rest of the family like this.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
They're that she don't deserve it, but everybody else deserve her to just be like, I'm selling mama house that. Basically, she isn't even in control of, right? To just make unilateral decision.
Well, and I have to go back
like
to the thing.
Pay for the house.
That we all say, always say, when we talk about this whole cut your family off, do this and that. Some of that vitriol I think we saw in the comments is coming from this philosophy that just seems to really have reared its head over the last years, where it's acceptable that you cut off family, that you just are like, I'm just going to only be down for me, you know, whereas I think if you have a more general philosophy that family is family no matter what, that doesn't mean that you can't limit or try to control, you know, stuff when it gets out of control. You know, the idea that you're cutting people off and that you wouldn't help them, you know, it's kind of like Teri is not completely self-made. OK, Teri's family supported her. You know, nobody gets to where, especially as Black people, nobody gets to where you're going alone. You know, if you went to school and college, somebody helped to buy your books, or somebody was cooking your food while you needed to eat. Somebody gave you a meal. Somebody did something. And in a lot of cases, they did even more. So, yes, you went to school and you studied hard and you did what you were supposed to do and you became successful. But your success is on the backs of other people who helped you. And you can't forget that part. Stevie McQueen says, I didn't think so, because even in real life, family has to help each other out. However, Teri was way out of line for putting the house up for sale after their mother died. She did so without even asking how they felt. And that is just exactly what we're talking about, right? You know, I'm gonna just put the house up for sale because that's the control you think you have. But they put that injunction. See, she was like, I'm the lawyer. I'm the one who can make these maneuvers and decisions. And, you know, what is Maxine, you know, going to do? Because
it really depends on who actually owns the house at the time. But it's like, as an attorney, you know, you're basically stealing when you do that.
She wasn't exactly stealing because she was going to give them their cut of the house.
That's stealing.
You know,
if you take my car and sell it and then give me money for it, that's stealing.
Well, what would have had to happen here? I kind of disagree with you in legally, not in
legally.
Morally, I agree with you.
Legally, if you take somebody's car and sell it and give them money, that's stealing. If I go into your house,
she had the right to
do it. She didn't have the right to make a unilateral decision if everybody have a stake in it.
At the end of the day, if you're the executor, which is the eldest daughter, and most responsible, I'm sure
that's
she would have been in the will.
That's why I'm saying it depends on how it's set up.
Well, it doesn't explicitly state that she's the executor of Big Mama's will, but I think the way that everything else, why wouldn't she be?
But how did the injunction stop it?
The injunction would stop it because it's saying we have to talk about this before.
Talk about who's the executor.
No, talk about the decision
to
sell.
You don't have to if one person is assigned as the person to make the decision.
Well, I don't know. I think you get your day in court. The injunction is just like, stop doing it until we can go to court and talk about it. The outcome may actually still be the same.
Yeah, but there still has to be a reason that you can call to stop it. It's just like no random person off the street can say, stop trying to sell this home.
But you can stop it because you are one of the beneficiaries.
All right, exactly.
You know, so at the,
which means somebody else can't make the unilateral decision.
I would say touche on that. You know, they could if you let them, but they also could attempt to put up a fight, which may or may not result in the outcome that they want. You know, I mean, this happens all the time when I think especially happen when there's like adult children that are the stepchildren. The stepmother is living and the father is maybe the one with all the money. He dies. And then the wife gets the money and then the children don't like what's happening. You see a lot of fighting happening that way too.
Yeah. Or like common law marriage. And
yeah. It could happen in those common law situations. Right. Because the family's like, oh no, it's all of ours. But you know, blah, blah, blah. But you know, which is why if that's your situation, you better be living in a state that supports all that.
And if you made it this far in this video, type family first in the comments so we'll know you're one of the real ones who watched this discussion to the end.
Don't forget to like this video and subscribe to the channel and check out one of our other videos on the screen right now. If you like fan theories, movie trivia, quizzes, and movie discussions, please subscribe to our other channel, Station B by Axiom Amnesia, so you won't miss out on any of our fun discussions.